All right. Welcome, everybody, to our second workshop on setting up your household food garden. My name is Jane Cherry from the Cooperative and Policy Alternative Center. We are a partner of the South African Food Sovereignty Campaign. And together, SAFSI and COPAC are bringing you this workshop series to promote food sovereignty pathways in South Africa. Last week, we learned about preparing your soil in your garden or your planter container. And if you missed it, Courtney will share the recording in the recording link in the chat for us, for you to catch up. You can also find it on our Facebook page and on YouTube. This week, we will be looking at what to plant with a brief introduction to food sovereignty and some education tools that we have developed. And then next week, we are going to look at the food commons, indigenous knowledge and growing indigenous crops with input from Earth Law Foundation. And in the fourth and final week, we will address maintaining your food garden and an introduction to agroecology with input from BioWatch. I'm just going to share my screen and go over the housekeeping rules. Okay. Please remember to use the chat. If you have any questions or comments, unfortunately, we can't take any hands. We are streaming on Facebook, so follow us at SA Food Sovereignty, and we are also recording this and we'll share the link afterwards. Do your homework so that by the end of this, you'll be able to look forward to eating fresh vegetables. And then just to say, we have managed to find three contacts for an agroecology advice panel. So if you do need someone to contact as you go about setting up your household garden, please drop me an email or you can DM us on social media and then we will be able to share those numbers with you. And then finally, just a reminder that we are doing this during the COVID pandemic, so please be sure to follow COVID regulations and you can follow at the link that Courtney has also posted in the chat. And my slides aren't changing. Let me try that again. Sorry about that. Okay, so here are our COVID safety guidelines, which you can follow at the link that Courtney has shared. Okay, and then just to reiterate that this series is not just about helping you grow food to feed yourselves and your families, but what we are really doing is bigger than that. And so what we are trying to convey is that we can feed ourselves, but also solve bigger crises such as bigger crises than household hunger, but also climate change. And so in previous workshops, John has spoken about having control over our land and what we plant, and this is essentially food sovereignty. So in today's program, we'll go a bit deeper into what food sovereignty is and how it differs from food security, and then I'll also share some education tools that we have developed. So today's program is in front of you, just a 15-minute input from me on what is food sovereignty, and then John will give us a 45-minute input on what to plant. And then you would have noticed that this one is a little bit longer than an hour. We'll have 10 or 15 minutes left over for your questions. All right, before I go on, I'm just going to look at the chat to see if I've missed anything. Apparently my sound has gone down. Could someone please just let me know if you can hear me by writing a comment in the chat? It might just be one person's issue. Okay, great. Thank you. I'll keep going then. Thank you. Thank you. Cool. Okay, so I don't know why my screen is sticking. Firstly, what is food sovereignty? So I'm going to begin my presentation by contextualizing the multiple crises that we find ourselves in. And first, it's the climate crisis. Climate crisis is here. In South Africa, we are feeling the impacts of this as the drought, which started back in 2014, has been with us until even now in some areas. It is the worst drought that we have experienced in a long time, and droughts like these will occur more frequently due to climate change. In addition, Southern Africa is warming at twice the global average. And this is just an illustration of different temperatures and different increases of global warming. This means that there will also be an increase in heat wave duration and frequency, which could contribute to the collapse of the maize and cattle industry in large parts of Southern Africa. And we will also see drier conditions, as shown in this next slide. On the other hand, it is also plausible that extreme rainfall events will occur more frequently across the region. Another issue that we're seeing along with climate change is biodiversity loss. And this is a serious issue as ecosystems are breaking down. We have 1 million animal and plant species that are now threatened with extinction. And key threats to biodiversity include climate change, deforestation, and industrialized agriculture. Second crisis is hunger, which we've all seen has been exacerbated by COVID and the economic crisis. And this is perhaps more visible now, but it is also a window into our future. With climate change, stress on our food systems, more pandemics and economic crises, we are going to see increasing hunger. I'm sure most of you would have seen the latest NIDS CRAM study, which showed that 40% of the participants in the study interviewed ran out of money to buy food in April. And it is from the study, it is clear that hunger is tied to loss of income, but also global economic trends and pandemics. And the reason for this is that our food system is also globalized. Hunger, stunting, malnourishment, obesity are all symptoms of this globalized, industrialized food system, of which the poor and vulnerable are victims to fluctuating prices and recipients of junk and non-nutritious foods. So, the food system is deeply unjust, and more people will be forced into poverty and hunger if we don't fundamentally change this unjust food system. So food security, we've all heard of it, it's a solution to the hunger crisis. Efforts of food security include handing out food relief packages, encouraging people to grow their own food, sometimes using GM or hybrid seeds and chemical fertilizers, giving out food vouchers or cash vouchers to people to buy cheap junk food from retailers. And these initiatives on their own are not sufficient to address these massive crises that we are facing today. Yes, we do need some of these efforts in the short term to alleviate the current suffering, but we do need longer term solutions. Food security interventions can also fall short because they fail to ask important questions about our food and our food system, such as what is the nutritional content, as John will elaborate on later. Food security also doesn't ask questions like how is the food produced? How are scarce resources like water being used? How is our land being treated? How are the workers being treated from farm workers to retail workers? Also, how is power concentrated in the hands of a few? So food security interventions do nothing to shift power in our food system. There is another solution which gets to the root of the food crisis, but can also address the climate crisis, the economic crisis, and also help us as we face future pandemics. And this is food sovereignty. Now, I'm not sure how many of you know too much about food sovereignty, but I'm just briefly going to go into the little bit of the history and then the definition. So the term food sovereignty was mentioned in 1996 by La Via Campesina, which means the way of the peasant. They are the largest civil society movement in the world with over 200 million members. And they define food sovereignty as the right of peoples to healthy and culturally appropriate food produced through ecologically sound and sustainable methods, and their right to define their own food and agricultural systems. It puts the aspirations and needs and livelihoods of those who produce, distribute, and consume food at the heart of food systems and policies rather than the demands of markets and corporations. So, the fundamental difference between food security then and food sovereignty is that food security seeks to address the issue of food and hunger through the current dominant food regime, whereas food sovereignty challenges this paradigm and seeks to build alternatives and attempts to address the root causes through a bottom-up and grassroots approach. From its rural beginnings, food sovereignty has spread to other countries and is taking root in rural and urban areas. And in South Africa, there are many examples of food sovereignty in practice. One example is the South African Food Sovereignty Campaign. And here are just a few illustrations of the campaign and some of its activities and some of the sites. SACSI is an alliance of activists, farmers, the hungry, workers, and civil society organizations fighting for food sovereignty at a national level, but also as at a local level as we try and build food sovereignty pathways in villages, towns, and cities. SACSI has also developed some tools to aid in our campaigning, which I'm going to share with you for further reading about food sovereignty. And so the first is a comprehensive activist guide on food sovereignty. And I'm going to ask Courtney to also just share the link in the chat. You can download this and read it in your own time. And hopefully later we can have a whole workshop dedicated to just this food sovereignty. But in the meantime, you can read it and start by hosting your workshop, your own workshop in your communities. So just to share briefly, the guide covers topics like understanding hunger and the food system. It looks at the solidarity economy, agroecology, organizing and mobilizing for food sovereignty. It is a really comprehensive guide, as I said, with useful information. And here's just two examples, illustrations in the guide. Here they show how the food value chains in South Africa are controlled by a very small number of players whose main aim is to make a profit from distributing, processing, and trading food in South Africa. But then it also shows a bit of the international picture. And here you can just see the extent of control in the food system and who owns what. Second tool is the People's Food Sovereignty Act. And I'm going to ask Courtney to please share the link again in the chat. This act was launched at a People's Parliament in 2016. It serves as a compass for food sovereignty activists as it lays out what small-scale food producers, landless people, the hungry, community organizations, activists, and movements envision a just and transformative food system to embody. In this act, we argue that a food sovereign system can't be achieved by government alone. And so the act doesn't cede all power to government, but sets provisions for the government to ensure favorable conditions for food sovereignty practices and ideals to take root. At the same time, rights and responsibilities are conferred on all persons as small-scale food producers, as they also have an important part to play as conscious agents in promoting a more just, sustainable, non-racial, democratic, and food sovereign system in South Africa. The Act recommends phasing out of industrialized agriculture, deconcentrating farms, democratizing the water commons, to name a few of the provisions. So please have a look at that link and read more about how we envision a food sovereign system to look. And then the final bit on what I'm going to share is just the food sovereignty strategy of SACSI, which since 2018 has been to deepen food sovereignty pathways in villages, towns, and cities so that communities don't have to be dependent on the current volatile and unjust food system, but can rather take control of their food needs and grow food according to need, nutrition, and tradition. And so we are currently scaling up this approach during COVID and are pursuing food sovereignty pathways through hub building. And this is just one example of what a hub would look like. So here we have some hub elements. The idea is that in each community, there's a hub which has some infrastructure like offices and training, market space, cultural space, for activities, a nursery, also a community food garden and food forest, seed banks, equipment bank and knowledge bank, a demonstration site that can demonstrate agroecology, composting and zero waste, seed saving, land use, energy and solar and water, and then also possibly a communal kitchen. And then, before I change the slide, we have tried to look at the numbers. So if we were to set up 1,000 hubs, and according to our research, each hub supports 1,000 farmers, ranging from household to small scale and community farmers, who in turn each support on average 10 community members, we'll be able to feed 10 million people through food sovereignty. And so that is 1/6 of our population. So just to wrap up, Food sovereignty responds not just to hunger, but it is also a climate, also to the climate crisis and the economic crisis. There's great potential for food sovereignty to feed our communities. And as we apply permaculture and agroecology principles that John is teaching us, we are also able to work with nature and cool the planet. But it is also very important, and what we discuss in the practical element today, is that we are also able to determine what our community and our children eat, to promote health, to face all pandemics, not only viruses, but also pandemics of obesity, stunting, and malnourishment. So with that, I'm going to hand over to John, to John's presentation, to follow on from here and to help us determine what we need to plant in our gardens to ensure that we get the most benefit for our health. And just to say, like last time, this is a pre-recording. So just to mention, there are some minor connection issues towards the end. But if you have any questions, please remember to write your questions or comments in the... Write your questions or comments in the chat. And then also ask your questions so that John can address them at the end. If you're watching on Facebook, you can also share your comments there, and we'll make sure that these are posted to the chat so that John can also see them. Okay.
We talked about some methods to create soil health. And we mentioned about ground cover, make your own biofertilizers, and set vermiculture and minimum tillages, mixing plants and standard beds and allotments, trench beds and pit beds. We also talked about plant checklist, like heavy feeders, light feeders, have givers, herbaceous plants, fruit trees, nuts and berries, and vines. Then today we are going to talk about growing food for nutrition and diet. And also we are going to cover about when to plant crops, the seasons of planting crops or planting calendars. And we are going to talk about crop rotation. How do you crop rotate your crops in the field? It can be in a garden or it can be a bigger piece of land. We are going to talk about crops that you can plant in a seed bed in preparation that you take them as seedlings and plant them in the place you want them to grow. We are also going to share about a new plant direct in the soil where you want them to grow, what we call planting in situ. So we are going to discuss all these elements as we go on. But the bottom line is about food sovereignty. How do we grow food as a sovereign drive, as a sovereign product, as a sovereign methodologies? How can we use grow plants to be free? But how can we be free if we do not address the issue of nutrition? How can we? And looking at this, we need to look at when politicians are talking about food, usually they talk about food security and they forget about food, food nutrition or nutrition security. The nutrition security is the key element in whatever we are trying to nutrition security. And food sovereignty, it's addressing, it's equal to nutrition security. Because when you have food sovereign, you are able to select and select the plants you want to grow in your on your farm. You are selecting the plants you know they provide a good diet for the family. You are selecting the plants that you are you know they are from our traditional of traditional way of living or from our indigenous people. The same with nutrition security. You are growing plants to address nutrition security so that at the end of the day, you are healthy, your children are healthier, and the plants that you are eating, they are providing the nutrients that you need. But the entry point is to make sure that you have diverse of plants in your farm. It can be a small garden, or it can be 10 hectares, but are you addressing the diversity of nutrients on your diversity of plants on your farm to address nutrition? When you are dealing with this, you are looking at good nutrition can provide good diet. Because if you do not address the diversity of plants, how can you expect a good diet for your food, for your the food on the table? How can you address that? So we are trying to say, if nutrition is when a person has to eat and drink enough of the foods that contain key nutrients and healthy, what are those key nutrients? And how can we bring those key nutrients to our body? It's all about planting diversity. It's all about planting variety of plants. And this is what we are trying to share with you today. When we talk, if we say that diet is about eating the food with the right nutrients for your body to function and resist diseases, how can we resist diseases? If you have one type of crop in your garden, how can you resist diseases? If you, all the food you use, you eat with the family, you buy from the shops, and the when you buy from the shops, you are not certain enough how the food has been grown. So here we are trying to say, you can grow your own food to address nutritional requirement, to address the diet requirements, and also to be free, to have a sovereign or on food, to have the right to food. So the poor diet or poor nutrition can lead to number of diseases in your body. So we need to address that. So in a simple way, we are saying we can group plants in different ways to make sure that you are addressing nutritional requirement, dietary requirement for your family. So you need to question yourself, do you have fruit trees in your garden? Are you planting fruit type crop in your garden? Are you planting vegetables? That's the first group that I can define. First, you check, do you have fruits in your garden? Second, do you have vegetables in your garden? If you do not have fruits and vegetables in your garden, how are you going to address the nutritional requirements of your family, of your body? How are you going to bring the needs of your body to function and to resist against diseases? Protein. What protein source are you using? Are you bringing to your family? Is it protein from the? Is it the processed food, or is the food from your garden? Because it's simple to have protein in your garden is to have pulses and nuts, legumes. The legume family. Do you have legumes in your garden? If yes, then you are addressing the issue of protein. Do you have nuts in your farm or in your garden? If yes, you are addressing the protein need of your family. Fats. We need to look at fats. Do you have the supply of fats in your, from your garden? Yes, I'm growing avocados. Yes, I'm growing seeds, which I can eat as part of fats, like sesame, like amaranthus, like the sunflower seed, like the seeds that are coming from plants, like seeds that are coming from vegetables that you can actually use direct a source of fats. And avocados is a tree you can grow. It is unfortunate that in Gauteng or in a very cold area, avocados, they take time to produce because they are prone to frost. But if you grow it in a microclimate where you protect it, avocado can grow. And avocado trees, and I'm nurturing them so that they produce the food that I require. Cereals and grains. Are you producing enough cereals for your garden, for your family, to address the nutritional requirement and the diets? And are you growing these cereals to provide the right food for your family? And what cereals are you growing in your garden? What cereals, what grains are you growing for your family? We have, of course, the Zia maize, the maize, white variety of maize you can grow. But it would be nice to go for the maize that are of high nutrient, the yellow maize, the red butcher maize. And these, they are good in antioxidant, so it is good to grow them. And the maize that are also early mature maize, like 2 months, 3 months maize is mature. And those are the maize that you can grow. Are you growing millet, which is more indigenous? Millet, it's more indigenous in Africa. So the most important thing is to address what is required, what can grow easy in Africa. Sorghum, it grows, it's a crop for Africa. And are we growing that to address the issue of grains and cereals? Are we able to grow sesame and also amaranthus as grains to use them in our food or in preparing of the food we eat? Raphage or fiber. Are we growing enough fiber plants, plants that can provide a lot of fiber for our body? And the main plants that can provide fiber are a wide variety of leaf vegetables. Any leaf vegetable can provide a good fiber, roughage for our body. And the millet that is not processed, it also provides a lot of fiber. But if you take maize that is processed, it cannot provide you a good fiber. So unprocessed, unrefined, sort of unrefined millet, unrefined sorghum, unrefined maize can provide you a good roughage. And roughage is good for your heart. It's good for your the blood circulation. So it is important to consider that. Vitamins and minerals. What crops? Are you growing crops that can provide a lot of vitamins and minerals? So a wide variety of herbs, from coriander, from rosemary, the plants like thyme, parsley, celery, even beetroot. They have lots of minerals. So you need to know which plants are having minerals to provide you with what you need for the body and for the family. Yeah. The antioxidants. Of course, they include vitamin C, vitamin E, beta carotene, and those are plants. Especially, I classify them as the color-like plants: orange, red plants, orange like carrots, beetroot, red. They are good to provide antioxidants. And fruits like tree tomato, some might not know a tree tomato. I quickly get a tree tomato from my here in my garden. This is a tree tomato. It is very good antioxidant plant, and you open, you can eat the inner part. It is a fruit, it's in my garden. I'm taking it from my garden, and it's good for antioxidant. It's a plant that you can use for salads, and a plant that you can use as fruit. But you grow it, it's easy to grow. So you select your plants either according to the food groups to make sure that your garden has all the food groups, is providing all the food groups that are required for us to be healthy and us to be resistant to a number of diseases. But it is important to know as well that when you do selecting of these, you go back to what we discussed last time about the hay feeders, the live hay feeders, hay givers, and the other groups. You can take all these groups and fit these crops into those categories that we shared last time. And when you put them in these categories, it helps you to know which crop can you grow as a heavy giver, like beans. And when you grow that, what is it providing? So it's providing you protein. So if you check here, or if you have your checklist, you are checking the group and you are checking the categories of plants to improve the soil. You check all this and check, do I have these plants in the garden? If you do not have, if you do not tick any of those, it means look for the plant somewhere and bring it in the garden. Then it can able to provide you with the nutrients that are required. So a step further is, because we are creating a garden, and I assume you have already prepared vegetable beds and you want to plant your crops. So planting your crops, it's you need to know the seasons when you plant certain crops. Because if you plant certain crops in wrong season, the production is quite wrong. It's quite poor, and it doesn't give you a good yield. I want to give an example of Gauteng. In Gauteng, right now we are just moving from we are towards the spring, but what can we plant now in Gauteng? Now we can plant a wide variety of crops, including spinach, mustard, beetroot, carrots, onion family, onions, garlic, and when you plant garlic, it's very easy. Just plant like this. I'll show you again. It's this piece that you can plant, but I'll show you how to go about it. You plant garlic, you plant all this onion family, and then you can plant maize now. Some might say it's quite cold for maize, but in my garden, unfortunately, I cannot show you, but in the back there, I have maize already germinated. It's growing. We can plant beans, wide variety of beans. For example, here I have the kidney bean that I have already planted. I have quite a variety of colorful beans, and climbing beans and bush beans that I plant, and I'm going to keep seeds and share. We can plant this season in Johannesburg. We can plant crops like kale, rhubarb, thyme, rosemary, celery, it's a long list that you can plant. But it is important to know what crops you can plant in this season. When you plant this, we have a way of planting them. I'll show you how to plant them. So we are told spring we plant these. But also we can think what we can plant. We can now start sourcing seeds for what we can plant in summer. And what can we plant in summer? Sweet potatoes, Irish potato, corn. We can continue with the onions. We can continue with the pumpkin. We can plant radish. We can plant vegetables like spinach and mustard, beetroot. We can also plant this. But when we come to somewhere in October, December, we need to reduce planting things like cabbage, because if you plant cabbage around there, they will have problems of insects that attacks them. And also spinach in January, we don't need to have lots of spinach in January because it's easily attacked by pests around there. So most crops like vegetables, they can be planted from March. It's from March going on up to September. We can stop in September, we stop planting lots of the greens because they can still grow, like spinach can still grow in the summer period. But the intensive planting of vegetables, let's start March. If it's cool enough, we can start even in February. And throughout in winter, you should have your crops in winter, like May, June, July. Crops should be well established, and they are already growing. And what you need to monitor is just to monitor them against the frost. Pests are not a problem in winter. So all these crops, the vegetable type, can be planted there. In summer, like in September, October, we can plant all our beans varieties, except the broad bean and peas. They can be planted in winter because they are winter crops. But beans like sugar beans, climbing beans, lazy housewife, those can be planted in summer, grow together with maize. Our watermelons, cowpeas, and some crops like pumpkin, butternut, all we can plant them in the summertime. So it is important to know when to plant crops. That's why we are sharing this. So when you are grouping them again, remember, as we say earlier, that the heavy feeders, they can be planted a plot on their own or a section on their own. Why are we doing that? We are going to talk about crop rotation. So if you have tomatoes and you want to plant tomatoes and you have prepared your vegetable bed, the main crop you are planting there is tomatoes. That's very important to know. The section you selected for certain crop, or depends how you have prepared the soil. Let's have the main crop in that unit, or in the specific bed, or in the field. It can be a hectare. What's the main crop in that hectare? It can be half a hectare or quarter hectare. What's the main crop in that field? It can be in a container. What's the main crop in that container? So in a container, the main crop can be, for example, we say tomato. So the soil preparation for that tomato is a hay feeder. The soil preparation for the tomato, it should be rich enough so that the tomato can provide you with good fruits, nutritious food. But when you have it in the field, you can plant it with other crops. We're talking about companion planting. Tomatoes, they grow well with basil. So the main crop there is tomato. So let's say you have 100 plants of tomato. So a quarter or even one plant that you are mixing with can be intercropped with. So you have tomato, 100 plants. Within tomato, you bring your basil in there, interplant with basil. So basil plants are only 25. Because basil is not your main crop. Basil, you are bringing it as an intercropper, as a pest repellent to boost the tomatoes. So when you mix that, it is important to keep the mixing with the only two crops, maximum three crops. So when you have tomatoes and you have basil in it, if you want to add another crop in there, you can add a legume because you want to bring in the nutrients back. So the maximum will be three crops. So that's the tomato, the main crop, and then the basil for pest control, and also the legume. It can be the cowpeas that can creep or bush bean. So when we have this, all these are food. The tomato takes longer time to produce fruit. The basil also takes a bit longer, but the bush bean can be 2-3 months, and then you harvest it. Then it gives space for the basil to spread. It gives space for also the tomato to grow or to be staked. In a piece of land, you are now producing three types of crops, and you have also benefited for soil improvement. You have benefited for pest control. So that's companion planting. You're mixing different crops together. You can have a main crop. You grow maize. Maybe you're growing the any variety like the yellow maize. So when you grow this, you plant it first. When it starts to germinate, then you plant your ground cover, like lima bean, or let me show you lima bean, like lima bean or dolichos lablab. This is the variety of lima bean that I have. It's some they call it pretty lady bean. It's beautiful. It's a lima bean, which is the creeper. So why do you plant a little bit late after 2 weeks? After 2 weeks of the maize has germinated or been planted. It's because this one is an aggressive plant and can stay longer in the field. So your maize, 3 months, it's mature. You remove your maize and the lima bean or lablab or even cowpeas, they continue growing in the same piece of land. What is it doing there? It's providing you also with the food. The leaf is vegetable. The seed or the pod is food. Also vegetable. And it's also fixing nitrogen and also soil. So having it there, it's also covering the ground and providing manure with the biomass that it has. Having that in the place, in the field, you harvest your crops, and then this one remain in the field. It's providing all these benefits. You can plow it back in the soil, and then you bring your potatoes, or you can bring your other heavy feeders in there to support or to utilize the nutrients that are already in the field. So that's the companion plant. It's important to know that we cannot mix the onion family with beans, because the beans, it is the it's a legume, and it forms the nodules that helps to feed the soil. So the chemical that comes, or the smell or from onion that goes or that goes into the soil, it hinders the production of nodules on the beans. So we beans and onion cannot be planted together because of that reason. So whenever you have beans, do not mix the two. But onion can be, or onion family, leeks, garlic and others, can be planted with any other variety of vegetables because they smell strong and they repel pests in the garden. With fruit trees, it is important to consider that we plant herbs around it, like garden rue. Garden rue is just garden. Rue is R-U-E, garden rue, which is a strong smelling plant. It's a plant that is good for bronchitis or other uses. I'm not talking about medicine now, but I'm just talking about the intercropping. So why you have it in with the fruit tree? It's a strong smell plant. It repels white flies from peach trees. It repels caterpillars. It repels a number of insects that can come to a fruit tree. A fruit tree can also be planted with rosemary. You can also plant fruit trees with imbepo, the African imbepo in Zulia, they call imbepo. You can also plant fruit trees with nasturtium. It's a plant that you can also grow with fruit trees. Fruit trees can be planted with the wild dahlia, the Leonetis rionalis. Also, you can plant with the Artemisia afra, the lingana. You can plant it with fruit trees because these are strong smell plants. They can repel pests from the garden. So herbaceous plants in our group of crops, like hay feeders, light feeders, if you go to herbaceous plants, can be planted with a variety of crops. Depends with the size of the plant. If it's a bush plant, like the Artemisia, the garden rue, you plant them with fruit trees. If it's a small plant, like short plant, like parsley, celery, those can be planted with vegetables. Even coriander can be planted with vegetables. You have main crop, as I mentioned, main crop spinach. In a vegetable, in a container, you have 10 spinach plants. And then you have two celery or parsley. Or you have only three coriander. That helps in repairing some pests from the spinach or even from cabbage. So the nuts and berries and fruits, all you plant them with the shrub-like herbs, and that helps in controlling number of pests in the garden. You go back also into this air feeders, light feeders. It also helps you in doing crop rotation. When your main crop is beans and the intercrop is other, you consider mainly the main crop. So bean as a legume, it's a heavy giver. So the most important thing is to bring, after that, when you are doing crop rotation, you bring in the heavy feeders, like tomatoes, like sweet potatoes, like because or pumpkin, because they want to utilize, they have to utilize the nutrients that are left with legumes in there. So when you have light feeders, you can bring them after after heavy givers as well. After heavy feeders, then you can bring light feeders. after heavy feeders. The light feeder, they don't need a lot of nutrients. So after tomatoes, for example, you can plant garlic or onion, and they cannot consume, they don't need a lot of nutrients. But crop rotation, it's only done for the crops like generally vegetables, cereals, and grains, and legumes. But you cannot crop rotate with fruit trees and vines. Those are permanent plants. Those are plants that maintain the structure of your farm, the layout of your farm. So crop rotation is also very important because it helps in killing or reduce diseases and pests in the garden. Because if you plant one type of crop every year, one year after another, or season after another season, the challenge is that one crop can mine out the nutrients from the soil. And when you continue doing that, then you are growing a crop where it will not be growing easily. Then you are trapped to go and get the synthetic fertilizers or chemicals for the plant to grow. So it is important that we continuously do crop rotation in our farms to feed the soil and to improve the soils. Crops like legume, you grow them like sun hemp, non-edible legumes. You grow them when they're about to flower, you cut them back. And then you mix them into the soil. Then after that, you bring your maize in there because it's a heavy giver. Then you bring your maize, or you bring your spinach, you bring your cabbage in there. Then the soil already, it's rich in these nutrients. So it is important to know how you are crop rotating and what will be the benefit out of that. Crop rotation, where you will use plants like onion. After onion, you bring something that is easily attacked by pests, like one cabbage can easily attack by pests. So you can bring cabbage in there. But now, when you bring cabbage after onion, we need to have to feed the soil again, because the onion is there to repel pests. But in this case, the soil will not be rich enough for cabbage to grow happy. So you bring in manure to feed the soil so that the cabbage can grow easily. So crop rotation is mainly determined by the checklist we mentioned, have givers and even herbaceous plants. So that makes easier to do crop rotation, and that helps so and provide you with the nutrients. It is important to consider what when you have prepared your vegetable bed or container, how do you plant these crops? Most crops can be planted directly in situ. You don't need to take them into a vegetable bed. So let me start by crops that you need a main bed. So you can make your decomposing containers. You're going plants in a container. You can use small container, like this small container, and put beetroot. So the beetroot is a seed that you put in a container and put manure, and then it grows in a container. To when it's about a month, then you transplant it. into your trench bed. Then they can grow easily and happily. Beetroot and spinach can be the same. You can do plant them in a container as or in a seed bed as seedlings. Then you transplant them to the bed you want to grow. But I will talk again about this because let me mention again that you can also do these vegetables in situ, like beetroot and spinach. You can plant them where you want to grow them. And when you plant them where you want to grow them, then you thin them when they germinate and they are growing. You thin them to leave a good spacing, for example, 15 centimeters apart, 15 to 20 centimeters apart. If it's 20 centimeters apart, you put two seedlings. But if it's 15 centimeters, it's one. So that's the between plants. And the row between rows can be 25 centimeters apart. So when you plant them, and you plant maybe five of them seeds, and when they germinate, all of them, they germinate. Then you remove three. If they are healthy enough, you can plant them somewhere, but you keep two on the side, on situ, and then they can grow. So other crops that you can grow in a seed bed are cabbage, mustard, onions, coriander, like this one, coriander seed, you can do in seed bed. But also all these plants, you can plant also in situ. This is mustard, because I keep my own seeds here. Small seeds, they are good in seed beds. But some small seeds, you cannot put them in seed bed, like carrots. Carrots, if you put them in seed bed and you transplant them into a vegetable bed or prepared bed or in a container, they can make fork, or they can make the root redundant in growth. It can be a dwarf, a very dwarf a carrot root. So it is important for carrots to plant them where you want them to grow. And usually carrots, when you are planting them, you mix the seeds 1:2. Probably one is the best way is 1:4. 1 teaspoon of carrot seed and 4 teaspoon of river sand. You put them in a container. You shake, you mix them together. Then you sprinkle them on the bed where you want to plant, where you're planting, where you want them to grow. That helps in the spacing of the carrots. If you take carrots straight away in the container and then you sprinkle them on the vegetable bed, what happens is they grow very clumpy together, and it's not good. They won't give you good fruit. Also, there are crops that you can, I'll just give examples, that you can plant direct. Turmeric, like turmeric, all the tubers, you can plant them direct because you hardly get seeds out of them. The ginger, garlic, the madumbe, can plant them direct. Potatoes, because I grow these red potatoes and the purple potatoes here. these you can plant them direct. And of course, any big seeds like beans, like maize, pumpkin. You can all grow this direct where you want them to grow. And small seeds, you plant them where in a seed bed, and then you transplant them. It is important when you plant these crops, the seedlings, the mulching, is you put a little bit of mulch so that the seed can get sunlight for it to germinate. But if is a seedling, make sure that you cover the ground and leave two leaves on top. The plant can grow and send its leaves. The best way of growing crops, accordingly, in your, it's easier to do crop, helping the soil so that some biofertilizers set a venue. Mix crops to help pest control and help the soils, create standard beds, and always, if there is space, you can do pit beds and trench beds if it allows you to do that. It is our right that when we are growing these crops, we are growing to feed our families with the right food, wide variety of food, diversity food, to address nutritional needs, to address the dietary needs of the family. It is our choice, it is your choice to make sure that you provide your family with the right food at the right time. And I would like to say thank you very much.
All right, thank you, John. John is with us. John, if you would turn on your camera and your mic. And then I'm sure you've seen some of the questions come in. If there's anything you want to clarify, John, you can go ahead. Thanks.
Thank you. Good afternoon. I've been trying to gather some questions, but probably some of these questions you can get them from this book. You can download it free, and it can give you some guidance of what you need. It gives you some information. You can also Google John Nzira, and then John Nzira Permaculture Manual. And you can find all this information in it. In this, you can get this book in there. Also, you can visit our website. It's ukuvuna, www.ukuvuna.org. So there are some information that we try to share there as well. But specifically, there are a few questions that I may need to answer. Somebody asked about the tree tomato, if you notice, subtropical. Yeah, tree tomato is a subtropical plant, but you can grow it in Gauteng under protected area. You create a microclimate for them to grow, and they can perform very well in Gauteng. If you grow them in areas like Venda, they grow very well, much better than in Gauteng. But here, because I protect them from other plants and planting them to the northern side of the building, they grow very well without any much problems. Some of the answers have been responded by a number of people in the discussion. We also have somebody asked about the spellings of the names I mentioned, like Wild Daha, it's WILD, Daha is DAGGA. And all these names are in the manual. The other one, maybe it's the Artemisia afra, is the common one that they've been talking about curing COVID, but it's also in the manual. Somebody asked about the sunhemp, if you can, when you can cut it. You only cut it back to go into the soil when it starts to flower, and then you cut it back, it goes back into the soil, you plow it in, it helps improving the soils. Yeah, there are other answers that were responded by some participants, and I'm not the only master on permaculture or on food systems, but there are other people who have been attending this who are greater than me, And it is important to share the knowledge all the time. The manual, we can download it free and share with others. And if there are some things that you think are not right, let's communicate and help each other. And the purpose is to help our communities to grow their own food, to have the right food system for Africa, not only for South Africa, but for the whole continent. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, John, for sharing all your knowledge once again. It is very insightful, and I've been taking thorough notes. Hopefully one day I can show you a picture of my garden. So just to have just a few announcements. Once again, sorry for the issue in the beginning. I forgot to share my sound, but hopefully by the fourth workshop, everything will be running smoothly.